أفلح من صلى على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي وثمرة فؤادي أبا القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
There is a request of Surah Ayat al-Shifa for two of our brothers in the community. One is Muslim Sayyid Ali, and then the other is a brother Muhammad. They are all sick and they need your dua. So we would like to request Amma Yujib for the two of them and all mu'mineen and mu'minat who are sick. May Allah give them the fastest recovery, inshallah. So together,
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. 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 أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء.
صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
قال الله العلي العظيم في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإن يونس لمن المرسلين، إذ أبق إلى الفلك المشحون، فساحم فكان من المدحضين، فالتقمه الحوت وهو مليم. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
One of the many stories of the Quran is the story of Nabi Allah Yunus alayhi salam. Prophet Yunus is one of the prophets of Allah, and is not just a prophet, he's a messenger as well, as the ayah mentioned in Surah As-Saffat. وَإِنَّ يُونُسَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Yunus alayhi salam is one of the prophets that Allah sent, and his full name is Yunus ibn Matta. The narration stated that he came after Musa and Harun. Some narrations say no, he came after Yaqub and Yusuf alayhi salam. But the point is, this Yunus alayhi salam, he was sent where? In the land of prophets and the land of A'imma alayhi salam. And that is Iraq. You know Iraq? It's known in the hadith, Baradul Baladul Anbiya wal A'imma. Most of the prophets that Allah sent to the world, most of them, they are buried there in Iraq. We just go through the list a little, just to know some of the prophets. Number one, our father Adam alayhi salam. Where do you think he's buried? In Iraq. Adam alayhi salam, who was the first man Allah created on the earth, when he died, he was buried in Iraq. Allahu Akbar. And not only he was buried next to in Iraq, he was also buried next to Imam Ali alayhi salam. And you read in the ziyarah, وعلى ضجيعيك آدم. One of those prophets is Adam عليه السلام. Another prophet buried in Iraq is also one of the Ulul Azm, the first Ulul Azm, Nuh عليه السلام. Also buried in Iraq. Not only that, not only Nuh, many prophets, one of them is Yunus عليه السلام also. Not only that, brothers and sisters, you come to the Imams, many of them were buried there. First you come to Imam Ali عليه السلام, is buried in Najaf al-Ashraf. You go to Karbala, Imam Hussein is there. You go to Kadhimain, two Imams were there. You go to Al-Samarra, there are two Imams also buried there. Allahu Akbar. Not only that, brothers and sisters, do you know in the history, some of the tafasir, they said, you know the Jannah of Adam was in Iraq. When Allah created Adam, when Allah said in the Quran, ادخل انت واسكن انت وزوجك الجنة. Where was that Jannah? In the tafsir, that Jannah was Iraq. Close to where? Close to Najaf al-Ashraf. That's some of the tafsir. Not only that, also our Imam Ali alayhi salam, he was born in Mecca. He established there and lived with the Prophet. But when he wanted to establish during the time of his Khilafah, he took Al-Kufa, which is Iraq, to be his center of his government. Not only that, also we have in the Ahadith, when our 12th Imam comes, Imam Al-Hujjah, Ajjalallahu Ta'ala, Farajahu Al-Sharif.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
When he comes, he establishes himself, his center will be also in Iraq as well, in Kufa, the same place Imam Ali alayhi salam took at his center. Not only that, do you know that also not only this, you know when a mu'min dies, when we die, our ruh, it goes to different places. A kafir, his ruh goes to a place, it's called in the hadith, Hadramut. Where is it? Located in Yemen. Another place where the ruh al-mu'min goes to in the hadith is called Wadi Salam. Where is that Wadi Salam? In Iraq. Allahu Akbar. A lot of ahadith talks about the importance of Iraq. Now this unit, the reason why I'm just bringing, just to mention the place and the importance of Iraq in terms of the Islamic point of view. Now this Yunus alayhi salam, he was born and raised in Iraq. Allah said, Ya Yunus, you were sent to 100,000 people to go and call them to Islam, to Allah, because they used to be an idol worshippers. Some narration said, no, they used to worship certain trees. Yunus alayhi salam, for many years he called them to Allah, they wouldn't listen. Except only two people believe in Yunus alayhi salam. The first man is called Al-Abid. The second person who believes in Yunus is called Alim. Two people, just two, not nobody else, just two. The rest of the Ummah of that time, they don't listen to Yunus alayhi salam. Then what happened? The Abid, he told Yunus alayhi salam, ask Allah to punish the people. Maybe they might think and come back to Allah. Yunus alayhi salam, he listened to Abid and he asked Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of Yunus. And Allah wanted to punish the people. Yunus alayhi salam, he decided to leave the place. Because he was angry at the people. And Allah mentioned, وَذَنُّون إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا. He was angry. But the anger here is not anger for self. It's anger for Allah. Because in Islam we have two kinds of anger. There is the anger for the self and there is the anger for Allah. Anger for self is discouraged in Islam. Islam encourages anger for Allah. Like Imam Ali alayhi salam in the Battle of Ahzab, when he sat on the chest of Amr ibn Abdul al-Amri to kill him, what did he do? He spit on Imam Ali's face. Imam Ali became angry. But that anger was personal. And Imam Ali mentioned, Imam Ali stood up and he walked around and he came and sat and killed Amr ibn Abdulwadd al-Amri. They asked Imam Ali, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, why didn't you kill him when you sat on his chest? Why did you stood up again? Imam Ali alayhi salam said, Adha basaqa ala wajhi. He spit on my face. فأردت أن يسقط عني الغضب. I wanted to come down. فأقتله لله وحده. So that way I kill him just for the sake of Allah. This is called al-ghadab lillah. All the prophet in the Quran, when they become angry, they are angry for the sake of Allah. Like prophet Musa alayhi salam in Surah Taha. فرجع موسى إلى قومه غضبان آسفا. Musa was angry. Our prophet, he becomes angry. Imam Hussein becomes angry. But the anger of Ahlul Bayt is not for the self. No. When they become angry, it's for the sake of Allah. Yunus alayhi salam, when he became angry at his people, it's because they failed to listen to Allah. So his anger is for the sake of Allah. And one of his name is the Noon. One of his name, Sahib al-Hut. In Quran is mentioned, وَلَا تَكُنْ كَسَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ. Well, the Noon is one of his name. Now, Yunus alayhi salam, he decided to leave his people. And he was angry for the sake of Allah. As he was leaving, Quran described his situation. He got to a river. Quran said, إِذَا أَبَقَ إِلَى الْفُلْكِ. Look at the words of the Quran, it's amazing, brothers and sisters. Quran used the word abaqa. Al-abq in Arabic, or al-ibq, it means firaru al-abdu min sayyidi. When a slave runs from his master, it's called al-abdu al-abq. A slave who runs away from his master. The same word Allah used for Yunus alayhi salam. Was Yunus a slave? Yes, he was a slave, but not a slave that you and I would think of. Does he have a master? Yes. Who was his master? Allah. In the abaqa ila al-ful, Yunus alayhi salam, he left his people running to catch a boat. He got there. Quran said he was able to get in that boat. When he got the boat started to move. Look at the miracle of Allah. As the boat started to move, then suddenly from nowhere, a big whale came and opened its mouth in front of him. Now they're stuck. The leader of the boat decided that we have to give something to this whale in order to rescue us. Now who are we going to give? Everybody's looking. Who's willing to be thrown in the mouth of the whale and die? Nobody. Then what happened? Then the suggestion came that the best way to do it is to write everybody's name and put it in the cup, and then whosoever name comes out is the one we will be giving to the whale. Now Quran, Surah Al-Shar'i, Surah Al-Shar'i between this. Al-Qur'an, Balad, is it accepted in Islam or no? In Islam, when we want to do something, are we allowed Shara'an? We want to do something. Can we do this Quran? Shara'an, is it halal or not? The answer is yes, it is. Even in the fiqh, there are some masail, you only solve it through Al-Quran, through Balad. And this didn't happen with Islam. Even at the time of Yunus alayhi salam, they did that. And Yunus alayhi salam, and this is one, is called one of the ta'ammulat al-Qur'an. Ta'ammulat al-Qur'an is here, brothers and sisters. See, sometimes if you read Qur'an, this is like a gift. When you read Qur'an, and you come across certain things, you want to know whether it's halal or not. Like we mentioned about the Qur'an. If you want to know, is it halal or not? Now, look at the next ayah. Allah said, فَسَاهَمَ يُونُسْ participated. That tells you that that Quran was halal. Because if it was haram, Yunus wouldn't be part of it. Because Nabiyun Ma'soom. But when the Quran says, Fasaham, meaning he took part of that ballot. That tells you that this balloting is halal according to the Sharia. And that is why Yunus alayhi salam took part of it. So they all wrote the names and they put it in the cup. They took the first name. And come to wonder and surprise whose name came up? Nabi Allah Yunus. Nabi Allah Yunus, we have to give you to the whale. Yunus alayhi salam wanted to repeat it again. They repeated it 2-3 times. And Allahu Akbar. Every single time, the only name that comes up is Yunus alayhi salam. After the third time, Yunus alayhi salam said, I gave up. What happened? Then they took Yunus alayhi salam, and Quran says, Fasaham fakana minal mudhadin. He's one of the low losers. He lost that battle. They throw Yunus alayhi salam. And Quran says, Faltaqamahu al-hut. They throw Yunus alayhi salam. The narration stated that as soon as they throw Yunus alayhi salam, fa'awha Allah. Allah then send the wahi to whom? To the whale. Allahu Akbar. Now if you wonder, Allah talks to the whale? Yes. Allah talks to them in the Quran. وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحَلِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to the nahl, an animal, the bee. So don't be surprised when Allah said, in the tafsir they say, وَأَوْحَى اللَّهُ Allah sent the revelation to the whale. What did Allah told the whale? Two things in the tafsir. Number one, do not digest this servant of Allah. And this tells you when we say Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. That's one of the miracles of the Prophet. Allah told the whale, Ya whale, when this servant of man, or this whale, when Yunus alayhi salam comes to you, I say, do not digest him. Two, do not break any bone in the body of this servant of man. Allah, the same thing Allah told to the fire, Ibrahim. Ya nar, kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. The fire burns anybody, everybody, except Ibrahim alayhi salam. The same thing. Everything in the stomach of the whale is digested except Yunus alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. And Allah said to him also, فَالْتَكَمَهُ الْحُونَ وَهُوَ مُلِيمٌ مِنَ اللَّوْمِ Allah said Yunus was being accused. Criticize for what he did. Now what happened is Yunus alayhi salam, as soon as he was swallowed, Quran goes to another ayah. Allah said, "Fanada fi dhulumat." He happened to be in the three darknesses. See the ayah, dhulumat, not fanada fi dhulma. No, dhulumat, more than at least three. What are the three darknesses that Yunus was in? The first one. They said, Dhulmatul al-Bahar. When you go down in the sea, it's dark. There's no electricity, there's no light there. The whale, after it swallowed Yunus alayhi salam, Yunus was taken down deep into the sea, and that place was dark. That is one. Number two, Dhulmatul batn. The darkness of the whale's stomach. Can't see anything. That's number two. Number three, Dhulmatul layl. When the night comes, also the darkness of the night. Fi dhulumatin thalath. Question. How long was he in there? Ya Yunus, when you got swallowed by the well, were you there how many days, how many months, how many years? Okay, there are different tafsir. Tafsir number one, say he was there for only 1 hour. Tafsir number two, he was there for 3 hours. Tafsir 3, they say he was there for 9 hours. The longest of all the tafsir said, he was there for 40 days in the stomach of the whale. Yunus alayhi salam was in there in the three darknesses. Then what happened? Quran said, "Fanada fi dhulumat." In that darkness, Yunus alayhi salam, he made a call. What did he call? 911. Which one is 911? Oh, now I tell you that one, 911. 911? See, in the Quran, there are three 911s. If you call Allah, I guarantee you Allah will be there for you anytime. Three sentences in the Quran is the most powerful sentence in the Quran. There are three. Number one, La ilaha illallah. That's one. Number two, La ilaha illa huwa. Three, La ilaha illa anta. These are the three numbers, like 911. Huh? Now take these three numbers. Allah stated in the Quran, Fanada fi dhulumat. He called upon Allah. Ya Rabb, what did he call? Quran says, Subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. And another ayah says, he mentioned Allah. Subhanaka la ilaha illa anta inni kuntu min al-zalimin. That is the sentence that he called Allah. And in Surah As-Safat, Allah said, Lawla an kana min al-musabbihin. At-tasbih, which is, La ilaha illa anta inni kuntu min al-zalimin. That's the tasbih of Yunus alayhi salam. When he called upon Allah in those names, the ayah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. And this ayah, brothers and sisters, wallah, take it as one of the best way to ask Allah. And this part that I just mentioned, سُبْحَانَكَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. If you look in tafsir and مفاتيح الجنان, من أعمال, تعقيبات, صلاة الفجر, it's in there. If you read it in the morning, before you leave home to your work, wallah, you're protected. المفاتيح الجنان is there. That is one of the a'mal of the fajr, taqibat al-fajr. When you read it, and not only if you read it, you will be protected. Also, your needs will be given as well. That is one of the importance of these ayahs. Yunus alayhi salam, what happened? The narration said, after the hours, all the days, all the hours that he stayed in there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered this animal, the whale, to keep Yunus alayhi salam out. There is no time to go into deep about the importance and the effect of the spear. Sometimes we underestimate some a'mal in Islam. Yunus alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in the ayah, in one of the ayahs, لَوْلَا أَنْ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. تَقْدِيرُ الْإِلَهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted Yunus to stay there till the day of judgment. But one thing Yunus did, and it changed. Allah changed it. And that is the tasbih and dua. You know, in the hadith, لَا يَرُدُّ الْقَدْرِ إِلَّا شَيْئَيْنَ. There are two things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wrote things. He wanted to happen that way. There are two things that can change the whole thing. Number one is dua. La yaruddu al-qada illa dua. That's one. Number two, was sadaqa. These are the only two who can change things. Other than that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he make the qada, nothing can change it. Yunus alayhi salam, he was able to change his own destiny through the tasbih and dua. The Quran said, Yunus alayhi salam was then brought out. But when he came out, what happened? He was sick. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَنُبِذَ بِالْعَرَاءِ وَهُوَ سَقِيم. Saqim means mariyam. He came, he was sick. Allahu Akbar. He was laying there in front of the river, at the shore. As he was laying there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Rahmatan minna. For rahmah, for this servant of us, Allah said, we made a tree to grow on top of Yunus alayhi salam, to give him a shade. Now at that moment, what happened to the people of Yunus alayhi salam? At that moment, when Yunus was going through this, his people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed the weather of the people. And the punishment was about to come down. When they saw that, the tafsir said, then they decided to do tawbah. And how did they do the tawbah? The history said, what they did, they invited all of them together. The entire city, they came together. Even their own animals too. They brought the animals, the cows and sheep and goats, all of them they came. Then they separated the male from the female. Male was put aside and the female were aside. And then they separated the little children also. They put the little children aside and they left the children and every one of them were crying. Every one of them. They were crying. Asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. At that moment Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted their dua. Yunus alayhi salam, after a few hours after he came out, he felt better and he went back. And Allah says, وَأَرْسَلْنَاهُ إِلَىٰ مِئَةِ أَلْفٍ أَوْ يَزِيدُونَ. Allah asked him to go back to his people. By the time Yunus got there, the people were already waiting for him. And as soon as they saw Yunus was coming, they all were so happy that he came back to them. Especially Al-Abid, who was one of those two people who believed in Yunus alayhi salam. Yunus alayhi salam lived among his people and he had a book too. He started to teach his people and they all lived under the leadership of Yunus alayhi salam from that time until Yunus alayhi salam died. Here there are some lessons that I want us to learn from this story of the Quran. Lesson number one is about the lesson about the Isma. We all know, brothers and sisters, according to the Shia school of thought, we believe that every prophet is ma'soom, infallible. They don't commit sin. And the isma started from where? From wilada ila al-mamat. From the day they were born till the day they died. That is our belief. That every prophet, from Adam up to our prophet, they all are infallibles. They don't commit sin. Now what happened to Yunus alayhi salam? Didn't he commit sin? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish him. What is that called? We said this is not a sin. In aqa'id, they call it, we have two rules in aqa'id. They call one, they said, al-nahi al-irshadi and nahi al-mawlawi. And there are two kinds of orders, don't do in Islam. One of them is called irshadi. Irshadi is like an advisory order. Like a doctor gives to a patient. Don't eat a lot of sweet. It's a doctor advice. Then we have what we call also an nahyil mawlawi. An order from an authority telling you not to do something. There are two differences between the two. The first one, a doctor's advice, if you go against it, you don't get punishment. But the second one, if you go against it, you get the punishment. Yunus alayhi salam, what he received was the first one. Nahyan irshadiyan. It was advice. And it's called tark babul awla. So he didn't commit sin. That is number one. Number two, brothers and sisters, is to learn about the danger of sin. Yunus alayhi salam, we say he didn't commit sin. It's called tark babul awla. But he has to pay the price of being in the stomach of the whale because of something that is not even a sin. Now what about the sin itself? This is for some of us who take sins lightly. Sometimes when you commit sin, it's like something that is nothing. Now look at Yunus alayhi salam. He didn't commit a sin. It's tark babul awla. But even with that, he has to go through this punishment of Allah. That Yunus alayhi salam, Quran said, he went through darknesses. Most of the narrations said he was there for 40 days. Now what about the sin itself? Sins? They have their own consequences to brothers and sisters. Some of them in this world, some of them yawm al-qiyamah. One of the sins When you go to the Aqmar, Imam Ali talks about them. Allahumma اغفر لي الذنوب التي تنزل البلاء تغير النعم تحبس الدعاء تقطع الرجاء. All of these sins, every sin that we commit, they have their own effect in our lives. Some of them directly, some of them indirectly. Some of the sins, not only that it affects the person who committed, some of the sins, it affect the family, the children of the person who commit that sin. Some of the sins, it doesn't even affect the children alone. It affect the entire community. That's why we have to be careful about the sin, brothers and sisters. One sin a person commit in the society, it can affect every single person in that society. نص القرآن. واتقوا الفتنة لا تصيبن الذين ظلموا منكم خاصة. Allah said, be aware. Be careful about the fitna, trial. Because when it happened, it doesn't affect the person who committed alone. It affected everyone around them. It's like a river or a water. If you drop something in the water, anybody standing next to that water, they get to get the splash on them. Whether they like it or not. They didn't throw the stone. But just because they're next to it, they have to pay the price of it. The same thing in the Quran. When you go to Surah Al-Shams, Allah talk about the people of Salah alayhi salam. Allah said, إِذِ مْبَعَثَ أَشْقَاهَا إِذِ مْبَعَثَ أَشْقَاهَا. The one who committed the killing of that camel was a man. One. But Allah said, فَدَمْدَمَ عَلَيْهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِذَنْبِهِمْ. Every one of them was committed is considered a sinner in that action. That is the sin. And the same thing, if a person also obeys Allah and the person becomes a good person, it also the children can benefit from it and also the society can benefit from good deeds as well. Example in the Quran as well, in Surah Al-Kahf. Allah SWT talks about the story of Prophet Musa alayhi salam and Khidr. And the third part of the story, when they get into this village, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. Quran says, the father of these children was the righteous person. And Allah sent the two prophet or two best servant to go and serve these two orphans. Not because of them, it's because of the father. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا. That is lesson number two. That our action, we have to be careful, brothers and sisters. That's number one. Number three, another lesson from this Yunus alayhi salam, is that whenever a person commits any sin, remember that the Bab of Tawbah is always open. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran about how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is willing to forgive a servant if a person always turns to Allah. Imam Ali said in Nahj al-Balagha, he said, من أعطي التوبة لم يحرم الإجابة. If you get a chance to ask Allah for forgiveness, he said, Allah will not deprive you from being accepted. All you need to do is to ask Allah's tawbah. After following the conditions of tawbah, Allah will definitely forgive a person. That is lesson number three. Lesson number four from the story of Yunus alayhi salam is also every person have to learn and know the importance of obeying the leader of the community or the society. The leader. And when I say a leader, I mean al-ma'soom. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a prophet or an imam, it is an obligation on every single person in that society or in that town or in that village to make sure that they all surrender and listen to that prophet. Why? Because not listening to the prophet itself is a sin and it can cost that nation a lot. Example, you go to our dear prophet's life. A lot of time they were companions. who didn't listen to the prophet, and they have to pay the price of not listening to the prophet. One example, look in the battle of Uhud, what happened to the Muslims? When Muslims went to the battlefield, they were the majority. They have the large numbers, and they were proud of their numbers. The prophet told the Muslims, they said, the prophet said, you Muslims, let's all of us fight them inside the Medina. They said, no, Ya Rasulullah, because of our large number, we should fight them outside Medina. The prophet said, I'm the leader, I know better, let's fight them inside. They said, no, Ya Rasulullah. They disobeyed the prophet. The prophet said, okay. They went and fought the kuffar outside Medina. What happened? They lost the battle. Not only they lost the battle, they lost the dearest people among them in that battle. One of them is Hamza alayhi salam. One of the things that happened, even some of the mu'mineen, they have to run from the battlefield where the Quran described in Surah Ali Imran. That they came back to Medina and they were hoping that the Prophet is there. Then Allah sent the Quran. It says, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ أَفَإِن مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْ قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبَ عَلَىٰ أَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِ اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ الشاكرين in تفسير إمام أمير المؤمنين علي عليه السلام.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
He was the only one who stood on that day because the people, they failed to listen to the prophet. So every nation, if they fail to listen to their leader, the prophet or imam, they have to pay the price. And that is one of the lessons we learn from the story of Yunus alayhi salam. The people of his time, they failed to listen to Yunus alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to punish them. And they fast and they realized it. And Allah lifted down. That is number four. Number five, another lesson where I want all of us to learn to take home, to take home message. And that is the lesson of patience. How? Yunus alayhi salam, had he was a little patient with his people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wouldn't have put him in that situation. Nuh alayhi salam, you look an example. Yunus alayhi salam, he lived among his people for so many years. But Nuh alayhi salam never gave up. And Quran talk about him in Surah Nuh, where Nuh alayhi salam is telling Allah about his situation. He said, Rabbi inni da'awtu qawmi laylan wa nahara falam yazidhum du'ai illa firara. For so many years, Yunus alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam never gave up. Patient, brothers and sisters, because patience is the key in everything. And our prophet, the reason why he was one of the best of all the prophet, one of the key was the patient. And Allah said about the imams, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا. Allahu Akbar. What a sabr. Patient is the key, brothers and sisters. That in this story, if we are to learn something, is to learn to be patient. Be a patient with self. Be a patient with the family. Be a patient with the community. Be a patient in every place you go. Because the patient people, Allah stated about them in the Quran. Inna Allaha ma'a as-sabirin. When you are patient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I am with you. And look here, it's called harful ma'iyya. Inna Allaha ma'a as-sabirin. Allah said, I'm with those who are patient. Allah, patience is the key in everything. Salat you want to perform, you need a patient. Allah said in Surah Al-Baqarah, wasta'inu bis-sabri was-salah. Even salat, brothers and sisters. Everything you want to do, the key is the patience for you to become successful. And that is the lesson from Yunus alayhi salam that we all should learn to become patient in everything we do, because the patient Not only is good in this world, there is a bigger reward يوم القيامة. It's called أجور الصابرين. So many ahadith from Ahlul Bayt عليهم السلام that يوم القيامة Allah has specified a reward not for everyone, just for those who are patient in this life. And that is the lesson we can learn from Yunus عليه السلام as well. That Yunus عليه السلام is ma'soom, but one of the things that he did not do a little extra was to be patient with his people, like our dear Prophet in Ta'if. When the Prophet went to Ta'if and he called the people of Ta'if and they received him with the stones, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was patient. Now what happened to the people of Ta'if afterwards? The Ta'if became part of the Muslims and is now part of the Islamic world. Why? Because of the patience of Rasulullah. So one of the lessons, brothers and sisters, let's learn to be patient with everything. In life, there is the trials. Sometimes Allah tests you with your wife. Your wife becomes your test. Sometimes a wife, your husband become your test. Sometimes your child become your test. Sometimes in your family. In your family, you have a brother, a sister, a cousin. It's your test. Sometimes at your workplace, somebody is your test. Sometimes on the street, somebody becomes your test. But how do you become, how do you overcome the test? You can overcome the test with the patience. Patient, brothers and sisters. Always, when you are patient, you will see the end of everything. And everything the way you want, it will be the end of the way you want according to the wish of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to develop the patience, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you in everything that we do, Ya Allah, help us to develop the patience for the sake of you, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. And Ya Allah, we ask you to put the patience in our heart and help us to enjoy the patience, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, Yawm al-Qiyamah, let us be among those whom you call as-sabirin, inshallah. And Ya Allah, we ask you, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin, don't put a trial on our shoulder more than we can handle, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, don't end our life unless we're true servant of yours, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, when our time comes to go, let us be the true servant of yours, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. And Ya Allah, grant us the shafa'ah of Ahlul Bayt, Yawm al-Qiyamah, Ya Rabbi al-Alamin. To your marhumin and all marhumat, let's recite Surah Al-Fatiha ma'a salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.